So, time for a new motherboard. I really wanted a B550 motherboard, or was waiting for them to come out, but I was really kind of disappointed with all of the various manufacturers. Like Gigabyte didn't have any USB Type-C header on the motherboard, and MSI didn't really make any super high-end ones. The only one I really like was the B550 Tai-Chi from ASRock, but that's cost more than some higher-end X570 motherboard, and of course it's not really out yet. So yeah, I tried or decided to try a X570 motherboard. Of course, I just don't want X570 to begin with, because it has an active cooling chipset fan, which is something I am definitely not a fan of, quite literally. So yeah, I'm kind of curious to try this one out from MSI. It's the MEG 570 Unify. It has a very beefy cooler on the chipset, and it should be semi-passive. So hopefully passive most of the time if you're not doing anything too advanced with the chipset. And of course, 2.5 gigabit LAN, and it has 2 8-pin connectors for the CPU. I believe one of the 8-pin connectors is actually for the PCI Express port, so you can really give good, clean power to those. And I really like that it has at least two 10 gigabits USB Type-A on the back. It has 3 actually, and a USB Type-C as well. So yeah, let's try and open it up and see what we actually get in the box. Of course, a CD that you shouldn't really use. Go to the website and download the drivers from there. Some advertising here from for other MSI products. They make, of course, monitors, graphics cards, and such. And thank you for choosing MSI. Of course, you can go and register your product, which I definitely always recommend you do. And you also get these stickers you can put on your SATA cables to really keep track of which cable goes to what hard drive or DVD drive and such. And you also get a quick start instruction, which is actually quite nice. You don't have to dig into the manual to actually get up and started. And you can see here it is nicely illustrated, and it's definitely all you need to get you up and running. Of course, you can always dive a little deeper into the manual if you are curious about something or something you cannot really get working. And you also get a little bag, and of course the full manual as well. I think motherboards are the only real products these days that you get a full-fledged manual in the box. So still kind of like this, even though it's a little bit paper waste. But yeah, a full-fledged manual, you can really get into depth with this motherboard, and also the BIOS settings and such in the manual. So any questions about the motherboard, you can pretty much find it in there. And you get this little nice bag here with all of the cables. Really like this. Of course, you got a little badge there you can put on your case or wherever you want to put it, with some double-sided tape. And you get a little, I believe this is an RGB header for, is it Corsair that uses this kind of header here? You also get a digital header extension cable here. Again, I believe this is a third-party plug. You also get M2 screws. You get 3 in total, because this one, of course, had 3 M2 slots. And also a 12-volt adapter here. I believe you can put 2 12-volts RGB lighting in one socket on your motherboard. You also get SATA cables. You actually get 4 cables. 2 of them are with an angled plug, and 2 of them with straight plugs here. You can see the second package right here. And lastly, we get the Wi-Fi antenna, because this motherboard has Wi-Fi built in. And also one of the reasons why I wanted to upgrade my B450 motherboard. Also from MSI, I have the Morta Max to get the built-in Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, mainly just for the Bluetooth functionality. But yeah, pretty nice antenna actually. Would have liked that the foot here would have some rubber or some soft touch below the foot itself, but you can actually put it on the wall if that's what you like. And of course, let's try and assemble it here. Nice shark antenna. So some magnets and some soft material below this foot here would have been nice, but else it works quite well, and I'm getting fast transfer speed. And like I said, you get 3 in total of these M2 screws, so you of course can screw in your M2 SSDs. And of course, the main character of this show, the motherboard itself, of course, in this anti-static bag, as expected. let's bring back the packaging. And actually, first off, try and weigh this motherboard because it is a very heavy motherboard. No RGB lighting or anything on this one here. It is just pure metal heat sinks. No plastic or any other fancy stuff that I think maybe Asus is a little too good at using plastic that looks kind of like a heatsink, but not really a heatsink. But yeah, full aluminium heatsink. Also on the chipset and of course on the M2 slots as well. Like I said, you have three of those, which is again one of the reasons I wanted this motherboard, so I can really use only M2 SSD. Two 8-pin connectors here for the CPU and the PCI Express. Full aluminium heatsink there. It is not completely dense. It is air in between the heatsink and the top plate. So it is not complete, but it is definitely a pretty beefy heatsink here, and it's definitely more than sufficient. And that beefy all-metal heatsink here for the chipset, really like that. And it is semi-passive, or in my case, it has been completely passive. I've set the fan curve to the silent profile in the BIOS, and I have not seen the fan spin up yet. But yeah, USB Type-C head on the motherboard, of course, fan headers, audio, USB Type, or USB 2.0 and 3.0. And you also get another 3.0 here with an angle plug and four SATA connections. Of course, only four SATA connections on this motherboard, but of course you get those three M2 SSDs instead, and all of your front I/O is connected here. Backside, not really much to see here. Just this nice black motherboard. It is a six-layer motherboard, so it is a very high quality motherboard. Of course, the backplate here, I really like this one. There are other motherboards in the X570 range that has more USB, but this is sufficient for me personally. And I would happily sacrifice some USBs over Wi-Fi, or to get Wi-Fi and Bluetooth instead. Of course, you have the clear CMOS, and you also have the BIOS flash button, so you can flash the BIOS without actually having any CPUs or RAM in there. And of course, this is where you connect your antenna for that Wi-Fi antenna I showed you earlier. And you have all those USB Type-A and a USB Type-C. And you have four 10-gig USB connections there on the back. The fan, like I said, if you use the silent profile, I have three M2 SSDs in mine at the current state, and I've not seen the fan spin up yet. So it is definitely a very sufficient heatsink on that chipset. And overall, I've had no issues with this motherboard. It is an excellent motherboard, and I really like that stealthy look and the high-quality construction. No plastic parts. I really hate that when manufacturers make it look like it has a beefy heatsink like Asus has a tendency to do, and below is just a small tiny one. But yeah, anyways, that's actually built in this motherboard, or build this motherboard. I'm replacing my Mortar Max in my case, which is the Fantex Evolve X. So yeah, let's just first start with all the memory modules. I have 64 in total here, and of course then install the CPU, the Ryzen 9 3900X. Just look at that little arrow there and make sure it's this correct orientation when you mount it onto the motherboard. And else, of course, depending on what kind of cooler you use, you might need to remove the already installed bracket. I have a Be Quiet Dark Rock Pro 4, I believe it's called, the biggest one they make, and you need to install your own brackets there. And let's just install the SSD. Currently, I only have this SSD. I have ordered a PCI Express 4 or Gen 4 SSD, so I'm going to put my Intel 660p 2TB SSD in the second slot here for now. And when I get my 1TB PCI Express 4 times 4 SSD, the Corsair one, I will install it in the top slot, of course, and I also have a third one in the bottom slot at the time of recording this video. But of course, I didn't film this, I only installed that later on. But yeah, put some thermal compound on there. I just put a P-size thermal compound in the middle, and then just installed that beefy cooler there. It is a fairly easy install, but I do like what Noctua is doing a little bit better, where the screw is actually attached to the the little bar you have to squeeze onto or screw onto the CPU or to the motherboard. But yeah, it is pretty decent to install this BeQuiet. And of course, next step is to mount the PWM plug here to the motherboard, to the fan or the CPU fan plug on the motherboard. Of course, the big CPU fan is kind of blocking it right there, but it is plugged in and should be ready to go. And of course, keeping all the wires nice and tidy here. Next step, of course, is to make sure you have the right standoffs on your case. This motherboard uses standard 9 screws, which is pretty common. And then, of course, just screw it in place. The backplate is, of course, permanently attached to the motherboard, which makes it quite a bit easier. And yeah, let's plug in that power connector to the motherboard, the ATX connector right there. And then, of course, plug in all of the other cables. You maybe need the quick start instructions or the manual here, at least to see where you should plug in the power cable, or if you have LEDs and such, reset switch on your case, of course you plug them in here. I only have the power cable. Of course, this is the, like I said, the Fantex Evolve X. And next step, let's install the graphics card. Of course, I have plugged in USB cables, as you can see here, both the USB 3 and the USB Type-C cable, and my front audio cable as well has already plugged that into the motherboard. I have made a review of this Red Devil 5700 XT, where I actually ended up returning it, but I bought another one because one of the issues I had was the clock of the memory was always stuck to the maximum, which meant high idle draw or power consumption. But actually using two GPUs, as you can see here, I have the 5700 XT on top from PowerColor Red Devil, and I have the Red Dragon also from PowerColor, but the Vega 56 down below. So only have one monitor to my Red Devil 5700 XT actually solves that issue with the high memory clock. And using two GPUs like this, I connect all my other monitors to my bottom graphics card and only my primary monitor to my 5700 XT. So yeah, that's pretty much it. So before it looked like this, and now it looked like this. Pretty much identical, not really much to see. Of course, the motherboard is below all of these graphics cards and coolers and such. So it's pretty much, it's very hard to see any differences. But let's actually boot up into BIOS. And of course, keeping our fingers crossed that everything works, because motherboard is a pain to actually switch out. But yeah, you can see the memory is not really running at full speed. So I'm just going to activate that XMP profile, so it will run at 3200 megahertz. So I will do that first, reboot again, hit F10 and save the configuration, and then we'll reboot back into the BIOS. And you can see now here the DDR is running at 3200 megahertz, which it should run. I only have one SSD in here at the moment, but after filming this, I have installed two other SSDs and not yet had the fan spin up. Of course, go in and set your custom fan profile. I definitely do recommend that. I'm definitely not a fan of fan noise, so I will always keep my system running at lower RPMs. And of course, chipset fan here, I definitely recommend setting it onto the silent mode. Then the fan will only spin up if the chipset temperature exceeds 70 degrees, which in my case have not yet been an issue or have not yet reached that temperature. Like I said, with three SSDs, I'm using all of several. I think I have only two USBs available. I use, of course, LAN, I use Bluetooth, and all of these are going through the chipset. So definitely using the chipset quite a bit. But yeah, I've set up the fan profile. You can also get into the advanced mode of the BIOS by hitting F7. Of course, setting time, and you can go into overclocking settings and all of that stuff if that's something you're into. I don't really overclock myself. I just run it at stock frequencies and just make sure I have a beefy cooler on there, so the CPU will, of course, run at the higher clock frequencies for longer periods of time. But yeah, let's actually get into some benchmarks. Geekbench first. Of course, you can see here results before. I got 11,187 in multi-core score. And after here with the X570 motherboard, Unify motherboard, 11,584, so it wasn't really much. Of course, this is comparing to my B450 Mortar Max motherboard. Let's try and run the graphics card, which should get the benefit here because it's running straight from the CPU. And this is, of course, the second graphics card, and you can see I did score around 10,000 more in this score here. Let's run the Geekbench with my main graphics card, which is the 5700 XT, and you can see here before 63,117, and after I get 68,703, excuse me. So it is definitely running a little faster here with PCI Express Gen 4. Let's get into Cinebench, and this is Cinebench 20. You can see at multi-core, I get 6,590 points before and 6,655 points after again. It's only a marginal improvement, so definitely it's not reason to upgrade the motherboard. Unique in Heaven benchmark here, I'm getting just below 60 FPS per second, or 60 frames per second, and after I get just above 60 frames per second. So yeah, definitely not great improvements coming from B450, but all the other features is definitely nice. Having 2.5 gigabit LAN built in, have full PCI Express generation 4 lanes to the CPU. Of course, I plan to buy a beefy graphics card in the future, so I could take advantage of that. And of course, having faster storage and have 3 M2 storage connected to this motherboard, also built in Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, is definitely a reason why I upgraded. And also because I run multiple GPUs. Before, the GPU would run through the chipset at PCI Express 2 times 4 speed. Now it would run at times 8 speed at PCI Express generation 3. So yeah, definitely a big upgrade for me personally, but if you just run one GPU and of course don't plan to overclock to the extreme, I think B450 is still a great motherboard, especially the ones from MSI. I have had no issues with my Mortar Max, and I still keep it and plan to use it as a test bench here in the future. So yeah, I definitely highly recommend the Unify from MSI. It's been very reliable, stable, and if you don't want a motherboard with all kind of plastic shrouds and bling bling and LED lighting, I think this is the best motherboard, at least in terms of X570 chipset motherboards out there. It is very silent and runs very cool, and it is very reliable. So yeah, highly recommend it. Of course, link down in the description if you want to check it out. Else, I hope to see you again in a future video, but that's been it for this one. Take care.